Spectacular Spider-Man takes place in high school. It's Peter Parker's early years, 3 months since he's been bitten by the spider, so he's learning what it takes to be a superhero. It all starts with the story, so our job is to make sure those stories are entertaining and interesting and keep you engaged and give you all the drama and humor and action that you expect for Spider-Man.
Marco, how many times do I have to take you down?
I've got a small team of staff writers, and we put together a basic plan for the season. We work out the basic subplots, and that's what all the cards are up on the board. Pink cards are Peter Parker subplots, and the blue cards are Spider-Man subplots. And we go through the cards, but we may pull cards off, or we say, no, we're going to move this down to this episode, move this up, or whatever we need to do to come up with what's the theme for the episode. And the writer goes and writes a writer's draft script. Turn that in, we get notes, that's the first draft. Do a second draft, usually, and then a recording draft.
As the casting director, and we started meeting really early on. And we talked about the style of the show, what kind of actors, what style of acting, that sort of thing. And we talked about all the characters in depth, and we go out and we start doing auditions, and we start doing callbacks.
We held auditions for 11 recurring characters.
In this case, we were really fortunate because everyone agreed across the board.
When we cast Spider-Man, we were looking for something that could capture both sides of who that character is. There's Peter Parker and there's Spider-Man. So we had audition copy for both Peter and for Spider-Man. Josh Keaton can give us the heroic at the drop of a hat when we need it. He can give us the nervous little kid when we need that too, and everything in between.
Well, I'm waiting.
Growing up, I basically was Peter Parker. I knew a lot about Spider-Man, not just from reading the comic books, but just from living that high school period. Spider-Man and the Peter Parker persona are kind of an everyman. He's not the cool guy, but he really wants to be, and Spider-Man is the one chance that he has to not only be the cool guy and be the guy that everybody looks up to, but that does the right thing, and that can really make a difference and save lives and stop crime and still talk some smack at the same time.
All right, Electro. Time to unplug.
Lacey Chabert is heartbreakingly wonderful human as Gwen Stacy.
You stop right there. I'm so not letting you wish away your big brain.
Vanessa Marshall plays MJ for us. She's fantastic. Really smart, really savvy, knows what she wants. She's not afraid of anyone, not really intimidated by anyone.
Mary Jane is very mysterious, but in the long run, she plays a very key role in helping Peter Parker mature.
Nice, Pete. You blew it. Again.
I wouldn't say that. I saved the last dance for you, Tiger.
I have the privilege of playing J. Jonah Jameson. So much fun.
Ooh, piece of advice, kid. Perfume doesn't cut it. He's effusive. Everything is big and loud.
But the guy's a teddy bear. I mean, you have to know that the guy is actually a caring father and a businessman, and all this stuff is sort of bravado. But underneath it all, there's a human being in there.
And where's my coffee?
Ladies, you may want to step aside.
So you can attack that young man? I think not.
Deborah Strang is just terrific as Aunt May.
She's a little bit younger and hipper than what we're used to seeing. But I think she's trying to find her way slowly and patiently. Sometimes impatiently.
I can't have you out till midnight. You're to be home by 10 o'clock. That's my bedtime.
But Aunt May...
If you're late, you call before 10.
Harry's different in this because he's kind of the weakling, which I can relate to, and he's searching for his identity in high school and trying to make it, and he's also got problems because of the fact that he is so wealthy and all. You know, people kind of think, oh, yeah, it's the rich kid, and so he's dealing with that.
I know you can do calc in your sleep, but I've got a lot riding on tomorrow's test.
Eddie Brock is an older brother for Peter Parker, and basically, they sort of grow apart.
Bro, you ditched the antidote effort to win a contest.
Eddie starts to really distrust Pete. He has a lot of real deep psychological issues, and they all start to really come to the surface. He starts off being kind of a nice guy with a tough attitude to just being this completely psychotic, deranged villain.
Got great actors playing great villains here. I'm Robert Englund as the Vulture.
Not Tombs now. I'm what you called me. I'm the Vulture.
I'm a fan, like everybody else, and it's just great to be on Spider-Man. Even though he can do just about anything on film now, I think sometimes some of the villains are a little diminished in film, whereas I think in animation they can really sort of achieve their greatness, I hope.
What is this? These skies are mine now!
Playing Dr. Otto Octavius.
otherwise known as Doc Ock. I've loved this character since I was a kid. I agree with Stan Lee. I think he's just one of the greatest villains of all time. And the villains have always been, for me, the richest characters in that world. They just have such depth and such great backstory and such panache. And so I'm just honored to have been picked for this part. I love it.
Rhino, you won the coin toss. Will you crush his skull or simply impale his heart on your horn?
The goblin for me is like the realization of an 8-year-old's dream. I get to find the craziest spots in my brain and just express them as much as I want to.
Spider-Man, so nice to see you.
That was the news reporter, by the way.
So the whole wanting to destroy you and take over your empire thing wasn't clear? Well done.
The very first table read was really exciting. Everyone had auditioned a couple times at that point, but it was the first time that everyone was in the room together. It was just a fantastic energy in the room. It was great.
Huh. Only six, huh? What happened? Lizard and Goblin had Knicks tickets?
It was amazing, because they've gotten together a remarkable group. It's some really premier voice actors and some really accomplished on-camera actors.
I love table reads. I mean, it's a luxury to us actors. And when I go back in there now to lay down my tracks, it's going to be better for me because I got a little bit of rehearsal. I got to make mistakes. You know, it's always good to have an opportunity to make some mistakes, play with something a little bit.
This obsession with Spider-Man is a distraction. It's Osborn who's truly earned my wrath.
I get the script usually a day ahead, which is important for me because it's difficult for me to read the English language out loud.
In this particular series, we're taking 4 to 6 hours to record an entire episode.
Yes, gentlemen, and Rhino, we're frustrated, but the arachnid will be crushed.
Hal is long gone.
And you can show up to work in your pajamas having a bad hair day, which we actors like.
As a voice actor, it's different than on camera because all you have is your voice. You have to kind of not be afraid to look goofy because you're just dealing with how you sound.
I don't think I can fit, and I don't do too good in tunnels.
James sets up the circumstances for us, so he gives us the world to live in, and then we can act in that world. Since we don't have much around us, we're in the sound booth all by ourselves.
And boom, he smashes through another wall. We see the moonlight right outside. We know there's only one more wall. Boom, he smashes through that.
All the lines are numbered, and Jamie will say, okay, we're going to do lines 1 through 7 now. And they do that until they feel that they've nailed those lines, and then they move on to the next part.
Let's start by grounding this bird.
Ah! Fool! This dog's not too old to learn your tricks. My tech is protected by reinforced steel.
The VO sessions on this show are a blast.
Basically, voice people who work in voiceover and animation, and animators too, we're all a bunch of big kids.
I like to have fun and mess around as much as anyone, so when an opportunity presents itself and we're not crunched for time or anything, then things will slip out every now and then.
I'm holding back on the spittle that usually flies.
Jamie really starts the day out with a very playful spirit that I think gives us permission to be playful as well.
Jamie is not only a great director, and he's very, very funny, but his parenting skills are fantastic.
He's really good at being sort of a master of ceremonies and making sure everything's flowing together.
He's a real actor's director. He really gets all the subtext, not just about making a certain noise or saying something a certain way. There's more to it than that with him, and we're really lucky that he's decided to sort of wrangle this project and all of us with it.
And Vulture says, to Spider-Man's ignominious defeat.
Defeat? Seems to me a job ain't done. Till it's done.
Hey, I was topside. Usually Yahoo's lost the creep. Next time I'll smash him myself.
We do that in a day, and then the cook takes over with his team.
After the script is done, we pre-visualize the characters. Every incidental character has to be designed. Backgrounds have to be specific. We don't just do generic buildings or generic bad guy hideout or generic car. Everything fits the character. Everything is about the storytelling.
Everything has to be designed. If water splashes, you design the water effect.
Our props are done by Taesoo Kim. And props are anything that move that isn't a character. Cars, stealth helicopters, green goblins, glider, pumpkin bombs, those kind of things. Our background department is headed up by Vince Toyama. One of the things we wanted to do with our backgrounds on the show is make sure that those were also simple and animatable, but still also had architectural touches.
Spider-Man does live in Manhattan, so that's kind of a challenge because it does have to look like New York, but we have to stylize it. You want it to look like the city, but still be animatable and not compete with the characters.
The storyboards are the directing of the episode. It's the staging. It's the acting. We're not on a set, so when we're storyboarding, we can decide exactly how the character is going to look, what his pose is going to be. Action is a big part of Spider-Man, and that's one of the most fun parts of storyboarding on this show, because really, it's free-handed choreography. Every car, every prop, every color, every angle that we do is all about making it as exciting and as fun as possible.
Sean and Vic work together to figure out the look of a character, and then they send me a rough, and I clean that rough up. What they want me to do is take this character here and put him in this pose. Now, obviously here he's morphing and changing from the human version into this lumpy and kind of scary looking version, so that when it appears on the show, it'd be accurate to the model designs, which we get that look like this.
Color is a very big component to the storytelling process of Spider-Man. We do not color our environment simply in day or in night. A lot of times, paint our backgrounds to enhance the mood of the sequence or the intensity of the sequence. For instance, in our Lizard episode, we have colored it to be like a horror movie. Another interesting thing about the Spider-Man universe, in the old comics, most of Spider-Man's villains had green in them. So I thought to myself, green is the color of evil for Spider-Man. And so you'll see some of the high school bullies wearing green. The villains are going to have a touch of green, and some of the environments that are not so nice to Peter Parker or Spider-Man will have that color green in them.
Sorry, I make it a rule not to partner with anyone green.
All this is put together into this huge shipment and goes to Korea, where they'll actually animate the show.
The Spectacular Spider-Man is a traditional 2D show, which means the drawings of the animation are individually drawn. It's not computer generated.
All right, Sandman, show me what you got. Or better yet, I'll show you!
Vic and I will supervise the post-production here, which includes editing the show down to exact time. After the edit, we do mixed sessions, which is putting the sound with the dialogue, all the sound effects, the Foley, the music. We put that all together in a way that sounds great.
You usually don't get the tingles when the bad guy's in plain sight.
Sorry, Spidey. Was I supposed to wait my turn?
This series is fresh and contemporary, but it still holds true to Stan Lee's original concept of all of the characters and their arcs and their complexities.
The series really gives you the Spider-Man that the comic books have and the movies have. It's the best of both worlds.
We're trying to be very true to the spirit of the show, just setting it in a very contemporary environment.
I know for myself and the crew of the Spectacular Spider-Man, we are all working very hard to give the fans something that they can take with them in their memories.
Spider-Man's no magic wand, but thanks to the webhead, Kurt's cured, and Billy gets his father back. So what if nobody threw a parade? Spidey stays 'cause Spidey's needed. For now, anyway.